Hello, ladies and gentlemen, it's the Historical Gamer once again, and today we're going to be playing Afghanistan 11. This is a new game by Every Single Soldier, which comes out today, actually. I think it unlocks on Steam, about 9 hours from my playtime, I think. I'm not quite sure how all that works. This is a sequel, if you will, to Vietnam 65, which was Every Single Soldier's first game, and this is really an enhanced version of that game. It's a game that puts you in charge of Allied forces, principally U.S. forces, in Afghanistan anywhere between 2001 and 2011. It focuses heavily between 2006 and 2011, that five-year period. The earlier years are just kind of tutorial scenarios, if you will. I tried out the tutorial 1 and 2 earlier today, and there wasn't really much to play around. It was just kind of introducing you, as a tutorial should, to the battle mechanics in the game. I have played the Battle of Lashkargah, I'm not sure how to pronounce that, in the preview version of the game, so I don't think we're going to touch that again. We tried giving Mountain Thrust a go, but that was also during the beta phase when the game wasn't fully fleshed out yet, I've already kind of shown it. Granted, it was a limited stream. I know some people are saying, look at Neptune's Spear, but that's the last battle and probably the most complex and difficult, I would assume. So I don't think jumping in there first is the best approach. I think what we're going to do is we're going to do the Battle of Panjwali, or Panjwai. I'm not sure how you pronounce that, which occurred in September of 2006 and is the 7th scenario in the scenario list. What I will also call out real quick is, while there is a campaign to this game, which was non-existent in Vietnam 65, Vietnam 65 was just a skirmish battle, basically. Every time you fought, random maps, random town names, and you just kind of attempted to control the map. That ability is still in the game. That is under the... I don't know what that means... that is part of the skirmish mode, but there is a campaign mode as well here, which gives you scripted scenarios versus kind of random things thrown in here. 2006 actually has quite a lot of the scenarios, relatively evenly split up. There's a bit of a lack in 2010 and 11 scenarios, but we'll be going ahead and we'll be playing the Battle of Panjwai, which occurred in 2006. And I'll go ahead and jump in. And yes, let's see here, actually. Canadian and Afghan forces involved in Operation Mountain Thrust moved east into the Panjwai region in mid-July 2006, so that's another one of the battles, to help clear the area of Taliban strongholds. Although initially successful, fierce battles broke out in Pashmul in early August, leaving 4 Canadians killed and 11 wounded. Numerous Canadian personnel earned Medal of Valor and decorations of mention in dispatches because of this battle. Following this, a lull in fighting was experienced, and Canadian and Afghan forces left the Panjwai region, allowing it once again to become a stronghold of the Taliban. The Canadians spearheaded a second operation into the region, strategically surrounding the Taliban and calling in heavy artillery and airstrikes. The Canadian forces then moved in to directly challenge the Taliban and would end up engaging in direct combat for several weeks as both forces sought to maintain control of the region. So that's interesting. This seems like it's mainly a Canadian battle, although I don't know if Canadian forces are represented in the game as anything other than U.S. forces. I guess we'll see. The Taliban have regained control of the Panjwai region. We need you and your troops to seize control of the region and win the hearts and minds of the local population. Expect a lot of opposition as you re-enter this region. Objective, hearts and minds of villages and objective alpha must be above 55, and the game with a hearts and minds score of 60. Okay. You will have 60 turns to complete your objective. All right. Where is objective alpha? How do I see that on the map, right? Villages and objective alpha must be above 55. Is that the whole map, or is that just a portion of the map? Huh. Okay. Civil affairs, we're starting at 50 hearts and minds. Okay. Personnel, we start with nothing. We have to go ahead and train up. Logistics, nothing to see there yet. Intelligence, 2 Taliban cadres are estimated to be on this map at the moment, so not a terribly strong starting enemy force, if that's to be believed. And our political liaison tells us the president of Afghanistan, which this is a randomly generated character, it seems, where, you know, this individual, Fahd Fireman, obviously not the president of Afghanistan, even though the game says he is. He believes in social reform, which reduces the amount of intelligence that we get. It's a pro-Taliban. This is the Taliban flag, a pro-Taliban position. He believes in security, however, so we get more political points when we kill enemy units. That aids the U.S., so that's why you get this U.S. flag. He's corrupt, I guess, or maybe he's fighting corruption. I'm not sure. All I know is it means you get 300 political points per turn, which is a pro-U.S. Buff. And then intelligence. So there's a cooldown period between intelligence of one turn. So I assume, like, if you get intelligence, then it takes another turn before you can get any more. And obviously that is a pro-Taliban position. So about evenly split between U.S. and Taliban-y positions. I believe this would be the second Battle of Panjwai, Neuhauser. You'll know more than me. This is being fought in 2006. So this is the strategic map. As you can see here, there's a river that kind of bisects this map. Quite a bit of mountains out to the east, but not a ton of cities that we need to worry out there. Relatively flat with a few mountains here in the south and in the far west. All the corners of the map are pretty isolated, you know, not really relevant to this battle. The areas we really need to worry about pacifying are all kind of in the center of the map, and they kind of start off center east and move center west. But all along this sort of river valley, you've got a series of different towns and areas that we need to pacify. So in that sense, it looks like there's some roads that lead out of our base area south that'll not do a great job of helping us link up with other forces. These northern towns are going to be hard to keep in close contact because they are located in the mountains. The southern towns may be a little bit more easy, but they're further distance. If we could put like gunboats down these rivers, that would allow us much more rapid transportation. There does appear to be a main road that does link up a bunch of these southern cities, though. That's what this dark tract is. It represents a major road. So all in all, these towns and cities appear to be quite a few really clustered around our base, which should be nice in allowing us to get out regular patrols. These southern towns are where the real challenge is going to lie. And again, we've got to get the hearts and minds score up to, what was it, 60, I believe it was, in order to actually win this scenario. So that's 55 in the Alpha region, 60 overall. So I guess we'll just shoot for 60. I'm not quite sure what region is what. Let's see here. Does it give us anything else? What does this do? Oh, it just shows that. So it just shows you your objectives. All right. So not much here. I guess the first thing is going to be getting some troops in these local villages and also building some roadways to these local villages. You see this one already has a fire burning. So does this one. That means there's intelligence available in the towns. I believe the developer of the game actually said that's supposed to represent a council of elders, essentially, where people are meeting in the town to discuss important matters, and if U.S. troops show up, they can gain some intelligence, potentially. Now, we do have this artillery unit on the map already that we start with, so you can see here if we get in a fight or if we detect any Taliban around this general base area where we've got four towns within it, within artillery range. So that's a nice starting fact is to have some artillery locally. We start off with some Blackhawks, some MRAPs, and some infantry. Ideally, we're going to go ahead and recruit some special forces. You can see here we start with 10,000 political points. I believe it said we get 300 per turn. So we'll go ahead and purchase this one special forces unit. You can see it asks if you're sure you want to buy it. We're going to go ahead and purchase two more infantry units. And then we're going to purchase a Buffalo, which is an engineering vehicle, which allows us to build roads, build fire bases, things like that. And then we're also going to go ahead and purchase a Husky, which is basically an anti-IED device. It allows you to clear roads and things like that of enemy improvised explosive devices. So that way you run a lower risk of running into bombs and whatnot placed along the roads. Because in Afghanistan 11, the roads are something you need to be very mindful of avoiding, given without proper support. Because as in Iraq or in Afghanistan, the enemy like to plant improvised explosive devices where they know American forces will be traveling, usually along the roads, and detonate them. And that can really be a key aerial denial tactic used by the enemy. So we're going to go ahead and purchase an Apache as well. And I think that'll be about it. So we've just bought a whole bunch of stuff. We've spent 3,000 of our political capital. We have to keep some of this as sort of an operating budget to do things like building, you know, water and other things like that for various communities. I think what we're going to do here is we're going to go ahead and take our engineering vehicle and we're going to link up this first village with some roads. So let's go ahead and get this buffalo on here. Let's link this village to some roads and we'll go ahead and do this. It'll cost 100 political capital, you can see here, to do this. And then we'll just kind of slowly build out toward this town. And now you can see this town is linked by roads, which gives you kind of a pro hearts and minds bonus, if you will. In addition to that, we're going to go ahead and see, can we get these infantry on? No, they can't go there on foot. So we'll have to go ahead and put some infantry in this MRAP, which is basically like a Hummer, except it's up armored and allows you to move at less risk. And we're going to go ahead and unload these troops in this village, and we'll see if we get any intelligence from them. Okay, so you saw we got some intel that there's an IED over here. So there's an improvised explosive device over here. You get a bonus to your hearts and minds score when you destroy IEDs. The whole goal in this game is to get a higher hearts and minds score, which reflects the local community's buy-in to your presence. Essentially, they'll like you more, they'll help you against the Taliban, and they'll do all of that in exchange for, you know, things like building infrastructure in towns, linking towns to roads, providing food to villages, UN goods. Essentially, increasing their quality of life will improve your relationship with the locals, which in turn will increase your hearts and minds score and make it harder for the Taliban to operate, and is sort of the measure of victory in this game. Okay, so our buffalo is used up. We reached this village, and I don't really know what else, if anything, we want to do this turn. We've got quite a few units, but we don't have any clear objectives. I suppose what we can do is we can get our husky out on the road. Oh, okay, so it already detected an IED and detonated it over here. So that's good. Again, I think that gives us a little bit of a perk here. So I think what we'll do is we'll put the husky on the roads around. Actually, I think it's already scanned these roads because it's just detonated one IED here. Okay, so we just destroyed another IED, and you can see we earn political capital for destroying IEDs when they don't hurt us and influence any casualties. So that's also worth keeping in mind. You can obviously move much quicker along roadways. I am leaving him kind of out here on his own, but it is what it is. So now we've got another MRAP. We're going to load up another infantry unit. And we're going to move the infantry to this town, which is not linked up by road, which we'll probably do with our engineering. Okay, so more IEDs detected. That seems to be the principal thing that these locals are willing to tell us is about these mines that are located in their communities. So go ahead and load these infantrymen up, and we'll actually try and get them back on the road to support the Huskies. Their next objective is going to be either one of these two towns. Essentially, we're trying to really tie up local support around these villages up near the headquarters so then we can move further south as this scenario unfolds. I think we'll also go ahead and get our Apache airborne. He's probably not, doesn't have anything to shoot at, but we'll get him over here by our Husky, so if the enemy does attack, we've got airborne nearby and ready to fight. There's a whole logistics side to the game as well, which I haven't really touched on yet. But it is there. Let's also look at training some Afghan local forces. Could go with an Mi-18 helicopter, could go with an Afghan artillery battery, or Afghan armed vehicles. I think we'll go with an Afghan well, that's 5 turns, this is 4 turns, this is 6 turns. So let's go with the armored vehicle. That way they can kind of keep up local intelligence gathering loyalty building, if you will, in these northern villages. If we can get some Afghan forces to handle that, then we can send our troops to fight the tougher battles down south. But with all that being said, I think that's going to just about do it for this turn. Actually, let's do one more thing. Let's go ahead and throw some infantry on this Blackhawk. And this other village has more intelligence, so let's go ahead and unload our chopper at this village in the north here. It's going to probably be a little while before we can build a road to it. Okay, and so we detected an enemy Taliban vehicle. Is this a technical, I believe it is? A Taliban truck with heavy weapons on the back of it. So that's actually a good time to go ahead and call in an airstrike. It does cost 200 political points, but this is a strong enemy vehicle that could be a serious threat to us. And I believe they can also shoot it at your helicopters. So we're going to go ahead and call an F-16 strike in on this vehicle. We'll see what happens. There you go. Blew him up, destroyed him. He is gone, at least according to that. We got 1,000 political points for it. And if we go into our intelligence section of the game, we go to civil affairs. Well, our Hertz and Myron score did go up. Doesn't give us a breakdown of why. But if we go to intelligence, you can see here one Taliban cadre remains. One Taliban cadre has been destroyed. And that was the vehicle that we just blew up. I believe that vehicle would be down here. Is where, yeah, where we blew them up. So, all right. So that's a rather successful first turn, I would say. I know that, you know, that obviously uses our airstrike. There's a four-turn cooldown for it. But again, it was, I think, a worthy target. I think what we'll do here is we'll go ahead and mount these troops back up. And actually, the Blackhawk still has quite a few movement points. So we can send these guys to this other village, which is another local village nearby, and see if we can gather... Yep. Okay, yeah, we did. So we got another enemy IEDs detected. And we can go ahead and... I don't want to leave these troops on the ground here, so we're going to go ahead and pick them up again and go all Vietnam route on them and just kind of keep flying them from village to village and keeping everybody in the loop there. Okay, so I think that's going to do it for this turn. We still have some infantry troops. We've got an MRAP that... I keep saying I think that'll do it for this turn, and then I keep... finding more things to do. So we'll actually take one more infantry unit out of our headquarters and move them up here to support this Husky in the event that any enemy troops show up. So we've got some infantry support on hand, and they'll start moving toward these villages. The Blackhawks will fly to the village over here, and then maybe we'll get the infantry to this village in the south. Meanwhile, back toward our base, we're going to continue trying to build logistics for these villages back here to really solidify our hearts and minds hold on them. But the key is being really aggressive, or as aggressive as you can be toward the enemy, so that way they don't get a chance to build up their base of support and their supplies. Because once they become entrenched, and once this hearts and minds score starts dropping, it can become very difficult to turn things around. I also don't know if these are really... I mean, these all look like they're American forces, even though, you know, an American flag, even though everything it talked about was Canadian. So I guess we'll see. Okay, so that's interesting. These militia decided it was a good idea to come in real close to our headquarters base, which seems like a bad idea, if I might say so. So what we're going to do, first thing we're going to do is we're going to use our howitzers against them, see if we can destroy them that way. There you go. So we destroyed them. We gained 500 political points for destroying that enemy unit, and we also, I believe, bumped our hearts and minds score up a bit for destroying these, you know, these bad guys here. So if we go to civil affairs, you can see we got a -5 political penalty. I'm not sure what that's for. Maybe destroying the militia. Maybe they don't want us to destroy the militia. They just want us to destroy the Taliban. I'm not sure about that. Huh. It doesn't really say. I'm not sure where that political penalty is coming from, but village visits, conflict, mines all help our hearts and minds score, but it does say we're at a 52. We've got one ANA unit in training, logistics, you know, again, -1600, but we did manage to connect a village to the highway. We've destroyed one militia unit now, one Taliban unit. So far, I suppose only one engagement. The bombing raid doesn't count as one. Two enemy casualties without lost us. That's our political liaison, and that's the scenario right now. So, I'm not sure. I'm going to use this infantry unit here and sweep for mines. just to see if they placed anything. Doesn't look like they placed anything on these roads, so that's a positive. This engineering vehicle back here can also go ahead and construct a waterworks for this village, which will improve their opinion of us. It does cost a bit of money, but again, it improves their opinion of us. And I think that's all they can really do. They could build a bridge, but there's no real reason to build a bridge to this village because they've got road link and they've got a water tower. So that's about, I think, as good as they're going to get. I think the next step, in my opinion, is building a road to these guys, which will apparently take two turns by the looks of it. So why don't we do this? Let's do... That is a road. So we'll move over here. And then we're going to... Oh, that was all of its movement points? Really? All right. Well, that was a mistake. Anyway, so our MRAP already visited this village. We helicoptered into both of these villages. So we've got a helicopter crew with some troops going over here. We're going to go ahead and drop them on this village and see what intelligence they may uncover. Okay, so these jerks are uncooperative. We're going to go ahead and pull our troops out there then. There's no reason to leave them somewhere that the people apparently don't like us. And I think we'll leave our chopper up here. Kind of already visited some of these villages. We'll leave our chopper over this way. Meanwhile, our husky's going to head down the road, destroying a bunch of IEDs on its way. And then we're going to go ahead and select our MRAP. And can we get our troops to this village or not? Yeah, we can. Okay. So we'll get our troops down to this village. Okay, so we detected an enemy militia unit, which is great. So these guys are in range of our artillery, but our artillery is already fired. So what we'll do is we'll take our choppers, fly them over here, and then engage a target from range and try and get these guys with our Apaches. Which, I don't know if they ran away or if we got them. Engagements. Yep, looks like they escaped. Okay. That's not cool, folks. They got away. Oh, shoot. All right, we're going to let our infantry off here. Let's see if they can move in on foot and detect anything. Nothing? Okay. All right. Well, other MRAP is going to send troops here with another village visit. Great. So this actually village is pro-US. You can see they've got a US flag here. So, yay, pro-US. All right, mount them back up. And we're going to send these guys over here. All right, I think that about does it for this turn as well. These guys still have some points remaining, so we'll just mount these guys back in these trucks, and that'll use their points. All right. Might need a second husk. Well, we don't really need to go down this road, do we? There's not really much any this direction. So we destroyed more mines. Those are more good things. We built that water tower for that village. Good thing. I'm kind of tempted to send these guys over this way and just see what their opinion of us are, but we can't move very far over roads, so I might as well just end turn two. Okay, so if we go to civil affairs, that political penalty went away, it appears, and we've had a positive change to Hearts and Minds. We're up to 52. Intelligence says the enemy has two militia cadres and one Taliban cadre still, so they rebuilt one of those militia units. Logistics last turn was much better, only negative 300 political points that turn, So that's always a good thing when you start kind of getting close to breaking even. It means you can kind of start supporting your operations. And then I'm going to go ahead and build some roads to this village. So we're going to kind of build up the side of a, not a cliff, but up the side of a ridge here and use up most of our political points. We haven't quite linked it up, but again, we're trying to link these two villages by road. One, it'll make them a lot easier to get to. Two, it'll make them much more pro-America. All right, let's... These guys didn't quite make it last turn, I don't think. All right, so no new intel from them. Our MRAP can go pick up our troops. Again, they're all moving off roads, so they're moving a little bit more slowly. And I suppose we're just going to use our Husky to keep these roads IED free at the moment. The other thing is your vehicles all use up fuel as they operate. So as you can see here, this Apache is actually low on fuel, so we're going to fly it back to the base to pick up some fuel. These guys, we're just going to send them back to this village again. We're kind of focusing on the northern provinces again, just so we get a solid base of support up here. And then we can slowly start moving south. So this village actually has a campfire lit, which we're going to go ahead and send some troops in, so we'll see if we get any additional intel here. And again, they're uncooperative. All right, well, we'll pick them up next turn. We're slowly, again, expanding our forces south. All right. So we've almost linked up two villages. I think we're going to buy another MRAP. What I'd like to do is load this infantry unit up on it. And we'll, that way we can leave one infantry unit back, you know, up here. And keep these villages in close contact with us. Constantly showing up to these villages is, in my opinion, a good thing and helps you build better relations with these villages. Okay. Thankfully, at least someone's willing to build intel. Are you talking about me or infrastructure because no one else builds infrastructure? Well, they're also one thing, keep in mind, this water tower is built here, but the Taliban or militia can come in and destroy it. So that's another thing we need to be aware of is that, you know, the enemy will destroy intel, or not intel, but will destroy infrastructure that you build. So let's actually kind of see if there's any Taliban operating anywhere near our troops or this village over here. I doubt it, but we'll just make sure. We'll use our recon drone, which lets us see anything in this vicinity. So again, gives us a much, if we zoom out here, we've got a good eye on a lot of the activities in this area near our base. So I really feel confident about our ability to lock down these northern towns. It's the southern towns that are going to be difficult. And now that I think about it, what we also probably should do is let's go ahead and buy a second buffalo. I know it's 1,000 almost points of political points, but really the key is going to be improving the infrastructure to these towns. And if we're going to do that, we need to make sure that we are, you know, investing in it. And so I'm going to go ahead and build move here, and then I'm going to go ahead and build some roads linking these guys up. Okay, so we'll link this second village up to some roads. That last road was unnecessary. And can we build a water tower? Do we have time to? Again, that's a lot of political points. Doesn't look like we can this turn. So we'll think about it. Water towers are almost 2,000 political points. I didn't realize that before. But we now have two towns linked up to roads, one with a water tower. Hopefully we'll get a water tower here. Let's see how our political points adjust after this turn. Warlords bumper crops. Reports from Afghanistan. More opium fields expected in theater. Okay, so the game also does simulate there being opium crops, which you need to go in and destroy. It gives you big political points for destroying opium crops, but that is something that the game includes. All right. So this village now has a water tower. Pro Americans, we reward you. Okay. Let's go ahead and sweep the road back this way. And then we'll go ahead and head back down the road. Because what I'm going to do next is I'm going to send this engineer unit across the river to this town, which was uncooperative. But we're going to link them up by road as well. Meanwhile, this unit here still has to finish building its road to this town. And now this town is linked up by roadway as well. We've got some troops, I believe, that we can go ahead and unload in this town. And those jerks are not being very cooperative with us. I could build a water tower, but that's really going to reduce our political points almost dangerously, I think. So I think we need to wait a turn or two to do that. Move our buffalo this way. Okay, and actually, I didn't get a chance to sweep north at all. I don't know if they're really uncooperative or there just isn't any new intel. I'm kind of worried there may be IEDs up here. Apparently not. So we'll keep these guys out. They're going to be running low on fuel very soon. And actually, one other thing I should consider is building a supply truck, which I don't... Oh, there we go. Supply trucks are cheap. But what they allow you to do is they allow you to... So here we go. We've got a supply truck. We can go ahead and put UN supplies on it. And I think that's free. And then we can take this truck and deliver UN aid to this town. Which, again, makes them like you. So we did that with the one supply truck. We're going to go ahead and do that with the other supply truck. Take UN aid to this village up here. Actually, we gotta move these. Let's go ahead and pick these troops up. Start heading back. And then we can go ahead and get this supply truck to deliver UN aid over here. And it looks like they've got just enough movement points to... Oh, no! There was an IED! I thought I had scanned that area! Oh, shit. Gotta rebuild that road, too. Another IED? Really? Alright, well, we just took some casualties. Yep, no, I understand villages only have intel when there's smoke rising, but it still seems to me like a good idea to make regular visits to those villages, and we lost some political points as a result of that whole fiasco. Damn it, I was just hoping that they were so close into the base that they were kind of safe from that. I almost need two huskies as well. How much does another husky cost? Okay. So, a little bit late. We'll go ahead and sweep some roads. Okay. So, somehow IEDs got... put there. We need to move our buffalo back to our headquarters to secure it, but I don't think we have any enemy forces to... I think we do want to build another supply truck. We just lost that one. And then actually, we'll go ahead and take that brand new supply truck. We're gonna... Oh, shit. UN aid part two. Okay. There you go. We got a plus two in that town as well, so they kind of liked us a little bit more. So there you go. IEDs, IEDs everywhere, everybody. Indeed, this seems to be the case. But I think that's about it for turn. Oh, shit. Forgot about them. So we're going to actually take our transport home because they're almost out of fuel. I don't know if they can get back in time. Uh-oh. I think they're going to be out of fuel next turn. I guess we'll see. And they may not be able to move. Although I think this actually, you get one. This is a warning saying you've got two turns, I think. We'll see. What unit deployed? Oh, ANV, Afghan National Army Forces deployed. Okay, yep, so we can get back to base and resupply. And an enemy Taliban unit or militia unit is spotted. Should be within artillery range. Where did our artillery go? Oh, they're right here. Okay. And an 80% chance of success, so let's do it. There you go. So the town gives us a plus +5 because we destroyed these militia people that were kind of harassing them and right next door. And we get a political point boost as well for, you know, doing that. All right, so these guys will go back to base to repair. These guys will go back to resupply. These guys will go back to base to repair. Our MRAPs need to head back as well, but let's actually stop them here at this pro-America town because the campfire is burning. Well, they just said they were pro-US and now they're uncooperative? That's a little bit odd. These guys, we're going to go ahead and drop some troops here because they've got a campfire going. Okay. All right. Meanwhile, our Husky will keep cleaning these back streets. And these guys are all low on fuel. Let's get them closer. Can we get them all the way back? Yeah. All right, so we're pulling these guys back so they can refuel. So rations and fuel are a thing. If you leave your troops too long in the field or if you leave vehicles too long in the field, you can suffer as a result of attrition and the like. Let's see here. So our ANV forces, our Afghan National Army forces, our vehicle is completed. Can we load some troops up for transport? So we'll take Charlie Company and we'll go ahead and unload them in this village, which has some intelligence. More IEDs. Great. I'm not sure how you found out about those IEDs all the way over there, but it's good to know. Okay. And an MI-8. I don't really see the value in recruiting enemy helicopters or enemy artillery. I would much rather have enemy infantry, but or not enemy, but infantry, but... Okay, so more UN aid is delivered. I don't know where Objective Alpha is. Like, where is Objective Alpha? Does it tell me on the map? I zoom out. Doesn't really say, does it? Is there something I'm missing here? Oh, Alpha's down here. Wow, okay. So we're going to need to get down there and start making these guys like us. We've ventured as far south as Barang, these villages up here in the north, but we haven't gotten down south. Now, the good thing is we don't need as high of a hearts and mind victory level down here. We need 55 here and I think 60 overall. So if we build a really strong base of support up north, that will allow us to move further south. And again, the scenario, I think, lasts 60 turns, right? So yeah, we have 60 turns to complete our objectives. We're only on turn 5, so we're still kind of getting our feet wet, if you will. For this buffalo, let's build these roads out here. We're going to have to build a bridge here. That's 500 political points. And then another 50 political points to... Again, trying to build infrastructure to connect these guys. Also, by the way, when an IED goes off in a hostile scenario, like where you take a hit, then the road gets destroyed. So just worth mentioning that. That Husky's done its job. The other Husky, I think, pulled back here. So So I suppose we're going to end up needing an artillery battery moving forward. So I'm actually going to go ahead and start training an artillery howitzer, because what my intention is we've got this base here with this artillery, right? So this artillery can cover these four villages. What I'm going to intend to do is set up another forward operating base, probably right around here, which will cover these three villages and will act as the springboard for our offensive into this southern area where there's a lot of intelligence, but I'm guessing also a lot of bad guys. If we go in, take a look at the intelligence, the enemy has now four militia cadres, two Taliban cadres, and one opium crop, if that's to be believed. We have not accomplished much in the way of reducing their forces as of recent, and I'm guessing they're building their base of support here in the south. This red dot, I believe, is that militia unit that we just destroyed outside of Tulak. That's my assumption, I believe. I think this helicopter, yep, this one already flew. So we're about done for this turn, but we've almost linked up four villages to roads. We've built two water towers. We've delivered various UN supply convoys. And I like to think the people in the north like us, like up here, but I'm not really sure. It's hard to tell. Our hearts and minds score is up to 53, so we've definitely made some progress, but we'll see how things continue to shape up as the game goes on. With that being said, guys, I think we're off to a good start. I hate to end here. I'm actually going to go ahead and end my turn because it saves at the end of the turn. Okay, so nothing happened that turn. In between turns, we did get some additional political points. But basically, this game saves at the end of every turn. And it is about 1:30 in the morning my time. So this game, again, maybe a little bit of a slow start. There wasn't a ton of fighting or whatnot. But we'll continue this this battle. We'll continue this scenario through to its conclusion on this channel. I hope you guys like the look of this so far. I'm enjoying Afghanistan 11 quite a bit. It's an easily approachable war game that also isn't too... It's not incredibly simple as maybe some of the graphics would make you think, like, oh, this is just an easy kind of like move your little vehicles across a map type game. It doesn't have the look and feel of like a War in the East type game. And yet it is still it's a very difficult game to learn, to figure out, to master. It provides a lot of challenge. And I've learned that to my own sorrow in playing the pre-release version of the game. But it just came out today, so I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Let me know your thoughts. And until next time, guys, this is the Historical Gamer saying thank you for watching, and I'm out.